Hi there, Marina. It's Jeff Maggioncalda from Coursera.
Hi, so nice to meet you. I'm Marina from Moscow University for International Relations.
Nice to meet you.
Jeff, every business dreams about scaling, and I can say that that's what Coursera did during this coronavirus blackout. It was 28 million learning hours that Coursera provided for all over the world. And I want to also to say thank you from all the academic community for you to make these courses free. So how did you manage to scale it in such a big scale, and how did you manage to maintain the high quality of the courses?
It has really been an incredible whirlwind since February. I mean, obviously, Coursera has been around for 8 years. It was started by two Stanford faculty who wanted to make world-class learning available to everybody in the world. We had, even before COVID, tens of millions, like, I don't know, 50 million or so learners on the site. So we already had pretty good servers and a pretty scalable infrastructure. But when COVID hit, we saw, according to UNESCO, 1.6 billion students from kindergarten through college had their schools closed. The first thing that we did is we said, there's going to be an issue and we need to provide better service, free service, to anybody who's been impacted, any school or student who's been impacted. So we launched a free version of Coursera for Campus in March. So since mid-March, more than 19 million new students have come and joined Coursera. 500,000 learners in Russia have joined since mid-March. That's up 270% since last year. The key to this, fundamentally, it's having good infrastructure is up and running. And we have a very talented team. We've been doing that for quite some time. It's having a team that trusts each other, that is obviously smart and well-informed and has very clear goals. So we have about 650 people at Coursera now. We have to be able to communicate really well with the entire company so that everybody is aligned and marching in the new direction.
You also launched some master's degree programs and bachelor degree programs. So you compete with the universities in their traditional form. And so what is your advantage in this competition?
I want to point out that all of the courses on Coursera are authored by universities. And there's some from industry partners, but we have 165 university partners, including 8 universities in Russia, who have created these courses on Coursera. So we think of ourselves more as a partner to universities than a competitor to universities. So one of our most recent degrees that we just launched with the National Research University of Higher School of Economics, HSE, in Russia, is a master's degree in data science. So it's a degree that's on Coursera. It's 100% online, but you have to go through the admissions process with HSE. You get taught by professors live. You get your grades come from HSE. And then when you graduate, you get a diploma and you graduate from Higher School of Economics with a master's degree in data science. So Coursera is really just a delivery system for the online degrees from our university partners. So a lot of universities are really looking to expand the population of learners that they can reach on a global basis all around the world as well. So reach is the number one thing that university partners are looking to Coursera. Another big advantage is obviously you can reach a population who doesn't want to quit work. So the average age of a degree student on Coursera is about 45 years old. So much older than the typical on-campus degree student. And using Coursera and doing this online makes it affordable and convenient for a whole new population of learners to get their degree online.
Yes, it's absolutely clear with all the advantages of Coursera and online education in general, but there are also some challenges. Nonverbal communication is also very important, so as well as the soft skills that they get in their negotiation skills and presentation skills. So how can we reach all this in online education?
When we do online degrees, we integrate Zoom. So you actually do talk directly with your professors. You talk with your TAs. You do group projects and talk live with your other colleagues. One of the really neat things about doing a degree on Coursera is your classmates come from all around the world, from every industry. You might have someone in marketing who works in Europe and somebody else who's a technologist who lives in Colombia. And you're working on a project together and you can really share your professional experience and your industry experience, your job role experience as you're doing that. And I do think that companies are really looking for those soft skills development, and social learning is a big part of how to develop those soft skills. The most important thing that I think professors can do when they think about delivering screen-based lectures is to break up the lectures into smaller chunks where they can have maybe 10 or 15 minutes of live synchronous lectures. And then you break it up with 10 or 15 minutes of self-paced asynchronous working and maybe conversation with the classmates. And one of the most important things is bite-sized videos and assessments and projects that kind of mixes it up as opposed to one long online Zoom video.
Are there any security risks for people who use Coursera, who use it and leave some personal information in your website?
Yeah, there are risks anytime you're on the internet, and the incidence of cyber attacks and the need for cybersecurity continues to be very high and growing, frankly. There's many really good architectures and software strategies to create highly secure platforms and delivery models. One of the most important things about Coursera is that we work with the largest universities and companies in the world. And so all of our universities audit Coursera to make sure that we have all the appropriate security provisions in place. And on the privacy, you know, we don't do any advertising and we make the data available to the university if it's the university students, and we never sell the data to anybody. So we do take all the precautions that are necessary. And as far as I know, in 8 years, we've never had a security or privacy breach at Coursera.
Tell us what your new project that you are working in now, maybe after the coronavirus, what is your next top?
MOOCs were started in 2012 with Coursera and Udacity and edX and a few others. And that first wave was really about lecture videos. So that's our current major next thing, is hands-on projects. And then I can see a wave 3 coming, which is really more about social learning. I think role play simulations will be a really big part of this. Group and collaborative projects will be a really big part of this. And VR and the sense of presence, virtual presence with others, will likely be a big part of this as well. And what will come, I think, next is probably going to be very effective soft skills learning environments using social learning.
How do you see the education in 20 or 30 years, both online and offline education, or they are all together?
You know, I graduated from college about 30 years ago, and I'm really struck. The domain of things that you're expected to know and to learn is considerably higher than what it was when I graduated from college. Not only do you need to know, you know, reading and writing and arithmetic and humanities, and ideally, you'll also have some global fluency about how cultures around the world interact. So there's a lot more that people need to learn now than they did before. And then I'll do 30, but 30 is a lot harder. I think in the next 3 years, clearly, we're going to see many more blended classrooms. So you'll have classrooms where some people are online and some people are on campus in the classroom. And the people on campus might then go online and people online might come to campus. So you'll be a much bigger blend of online and in person. And so with online learning, you can deliver good learning experiences at lower cost. I think that there will be a reduction in the cost of online learning and the cost of earning a degree. The final one is that this is going to be something that you do not just for 4 years when you're at college. Lifelong learning, learning the entire time that you're at work and online, because you're going to be working, is going to be another big feature of the next 3 years or so. So I think that the next 30 years will accelerate much faster than they ever have before. And technology will be incredibly important. We really think at Coursera that learning is the source of human progress. It's the most important thing that humanity needs to do, because it will give us hope to shape the world in a way that will be a place that we all want to live in the future.
Jeff, wow, that's very inspiring. I'm also interested about how do you see the role of business in the education. What would you advise to companies? As I know, you have a lot of corporate courses as well.
Well, I would say that businesses, well, all institutions play a very important role in the education of individuals. And not only higher education institutions, but businesses and governments as well, which is why we have Coursera for Business, Coursera for Government, and Coursera for Campus. All three of those institutions are incredibly important, especially for businesses in a world where confidence, individual confidence in other human institutions is really dropping. Often the most confidence is in businesses. So I think businesses can certainly be educators who provide good education to individuals. I also think that businesses should lead in the transformation of society to create a more just and equitable world. And so I think the responsibility of businesses is playing a larger and larger role in the landscape of all countries around the world.
Thank you very much for such an inspiring speech.
Rina, thank you very much for having me. It's been a pleasure chatting with you, and look forward to working with you and your institution in the years ahead.
Thank you, Jeff. Goodbye.